And it's like a whole new generational shift in India also. It's like our parents never had the chance. They were just like, the first chance someone was tied to them, they were like, okay, let's do this. And
plug and socket.
Yeah, and like, you know,
VR extension cords.
A lot of people say that like they didn't get the chance to fall in love. Like the earlier generation that was trying to make it in Bombay especially, they were so busy working and making ends meet, they really didn't have the time. And as you said earlier, like your mom
or
and dad.
The apps.
Yeah, all the apps.
Yeah.
Like my parents basically were trying to make ends meet and basically were taking like 1-2 year shift between going to Kuwait and taking care of my sisters. So they never really met each other properly until like years later my dad was finally like done with his job and moved and started staying home.
Okay.
My mom's like, oh shit, like this is the person I married. Like she realized 30 years later that happened to her.
Okay.
And you know, but like our generation is totally different. We just like, we go for the juicy parts of each other's interests and sexual likes on our apps and then immediately go for it.
Yeah. We also have a lot of friends in our lives, right? I don't think our parents had that many friends. So even if your partner is pissing you off, you can fuck off and go meet your friend and just hang out with them.
But sometimes I can't help but think, like, if our parents at least thought it, like, oh, I've this penis for the rest of my life, or this is the vagina I have to fuck for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
Like, I wonder if they thought it, at least. I don't know.
I don't think we think it as for the rest
or
of
me.
Our lives.
Okay, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
We even for our
or,
careers
for us,
in
it's
lives.
An option. For them, it wasn't, is what I'm guessing.
As long as it lasts.
Okay.
You know, that's like the eventuality of it.
I really wonder what kind of like conditioning goes into starting to think like that, because even I come from an extremely violent, like not violent, but like an extremely dysfunctional family. We were never at peace. We still aren't in a lot of ways. But my dad's repeated sentences, at least she'd not cheat. At least she's on, you know.
Yeah, how would you feel if your mom had a boyfriend?
I mean, cool.
Now, I would love it. Like, if I at least, I think about this a lot of times. Like, because, you know, a lot of times I feel, oh, for the kids, we are in this for the kids. We stayed together for the kids. I feel like a lot of parents do that.
Yeah.
And now that they don't have to stay for the kids, I just wish they had more enriched, colorful, not that... At least in my case, again, with my dad's Alzheimer's and my mom's this, they've somehow gravitated towards each other after all these years with almost 3 separations. My parents have separated 3 times and they've got back together. They are one of those people. But now sometimes I can't help but think, like, I wish just sometimes, like, fuck, I found, like, my mom has a new lover, or like, wow, I wish they never...
So when they separated, did they not find someone...
I don't think so. I really don't think
They're
so.
Like, only this person can handle us.
I know
so
it
bad.
Might sound like I'm in denial of something, but I genuinely just know. You know, my dad early on told me one thing which I'll never forget, and I feel like it applied the most to his marriage, which was 2 people don't stay together because they are happy. You know what I mean? And it really, that's a coin that has dropped so far into my psyche, because I really, from talking about toxic relationships, I realized that I was in a toxic relationship for as long as I was, also because I was... Even unhappiness is a reason to stay together. Or misery sometimes, like, you know, that makes you feel alive. Or toxicity, like, that makes you feel alive.
Yeah.
So generally when I hear about abusive or like toxic relationships, I'm not someone to like sit and judge why are they together, or why. I just know that they're stuck, you know?
Yeah.
And they're feeling alive on a daily, because that's what it becomes in the end, you know.
Like, one of the guys I dated once, like the same guy from Bangalore, the biker one, And like, he one day like randomly asked me, like, you know, I once hit one of my boyfriends in anger, and like, if I ever did that to you, would you leave me? And I'm like, fuck yes.
On one of your 7 bikes.
Yeah. And he was aghast that I would say yes to leaving if he hit me. I'm like, dude, yes, like, why would you think...
Why was he asking you that?
He was an asshole, that's why. Like, you know, like,
he wanted to hit him.
Yeah, he was one of those buff, like, muscular dudes who hits the gym, and like, you know, the very macho, like, you know, some gays run extremely to the other side to like prove themselves as a macho, you know, a very emotionally aloof person. But then, like, when you meet them and you date them, you know that they are like entirely broken from the inside because of this whole facade of macho-ness that they are kind of carrying around. And I felt for that guy, but I was like, this is not for me. I'm not going to like babysit a 33-year-old man. And that's my thing. I've just like, from relationship to relationship, when I go, I feel that, okay, there's a sense of stability here. But also I find other people attractive, and I can't do anything about it. I imagine fucking them, like, you know, that's how it is for me. And I've had this duality, like, with my last relationship. I came out on the first day and I said to my boyfriend that I don't want to be monogamous, because that's not who I am. And I realized that the more I look into myself, the more I realize that my body is something I really want to like share with more people.
Got it.
And that's a weird zone to come from. I don't know.
I totally get it.